Okay, good morning to one and all. This is Dr. Mahesh M. Onjeri, Assistant Professor from Department of Management Studies, SDM College of Engineering and Technology, Dharwad. So this online class is conducted for MBA semester for students in the subject Supply Chain Management. So today we are going to continue with the discussion on chapter number 10, Coordination in the Supply Chain from Unit 6. So before I continue, the managerial levers, let us take a small recap of what we have discussed in the previous class. So we have learned lack of supply chain coordination and the bullwhip effect. So supply chain coordination improves when we have learned then supply chain, what it takes for supply chain coordination, we have learned. Then what happens? Lack of coordination results. So when lack of coordination results in a supply chain, we have learned so far. Then we understood what is the meaning of a bullwhip effect and reasons for the bullwhip effect. Then the effect of lack of coordination on performance, or when the bullwhip effect happens. So what impact it has on the supply chain performance, I have discussed. Then obstacles to achieve coordination in a supply chain, we have learned so far. Okay, so before that, just let me read you quickly. The obstacles to achieve coordination in a supply chain, so are the barriers. So they include incentive obstacles, information processing obstacles, operational obstacles, pricing obstacles, and behavioral obstacles. So these are the problems. And managerial levers are the solutions to these problems. So after a discussion on obstacles to coordination, we have started discussing the managerial levers to achieve coordination in a supply chain, means how to overcome these problems and achieve coordination in the supply chain. So far we have discussed, couple of these. Okay, so we are now discussing managerial levers to achieve coordination. So in that we have learned aligning goals and incentives. So the first one, then the second one. Yeah, so here we were discussing the first managerial lever, a strategy to achieve coordination or to overcome the problem of obstacle of incentives. So the first managerial lever to achieve coordination or to overcome the problem of incentive obstacle is realigning goals and incentives. So I have learned so far that align the incentives across functions. It should not be localized. Then how to price, for achieving coordination, we have learned. Then we also learned incentive based on sales for a rolling horizon, means over a period of time, incentive can be paid to the wholesalers or to the sales representatives. So this last point was remaining. Okay, so I'll continue from here. So we are learning pricing for coordination, aligning goals and incentives. So here we are talking about the sales force or sales representative incentives. So alter the sales force incentives from sell-in to the retailer to sell-through by the retailer. Okay, so here we are talking about a manufacturer like Procter & Gamble selling directly to the organized retail chain like Walmart. Okay, so the sales reps involved in this business. Okay, sell directly to the Walmart. Okay, so sell-in is what Procter & Gamble sells to retailer Walmart. Sell-through is actual sales made by the Walmart of Procter & Gamble products. Okay, so generally what happens is the sales reps are paid incentives based on the sell-in or orders taken from the retailers like Walmart. Here I'm talking about organized retail chains. Okay. Similarly, in countries like India, sales force incentives from sell-in are based on the sales made to the wholesalers or distributors. Okay. So what happens is the organized retail chain like Walmart may purchase from Procter & Gamble. And the sales reps get the incentives only on based on the sell-in, that is the sales made from P&G to Walmart. Okay, but the stock may remain unsold at Walmart stores. Okay, so in that case, in the lack of this information, okay, Procter & Gamble will gear up its production schedule to meet the next order of Walmart, which will be based on the previous month's order. But wherein, if a lot of stock is unsold by the retailer, okay, his next month's order will be very smaller one. But whereas the manufacturer like Procter & Gamble might have ended, okay, buying excess raw materials, okay, and then manufacturing additional goods, okay, which will remain unsold in the supply chain. So that's why to reduce this effect, the company like Procter & Gamble can align the incentives based on sell-through. Okay, how much of the Procter & Gamble's products are actually sold by the retailers like Walmart? So the sales reps incentives can be based on sell-through, that is so sale by the retailer in this case. In countries like India, sale by the wholesalers or distributors to retailers. Okay, so this way, when the sales force incentives are aligned, it reduces the bullwhip effect. So now we completed the discussion on the first managerial lever, how to overcome the incentive obstacle by realigning the goals and incentives to achieve coordination. Now I'll move on to the second managerial lever, improving information accuracy. So this managerial lever, okay, helps the company to overcome the information processing obstacles. So the obstacles created by information processing, okay, will be overcome by this managerial lever, improving information accuracy. So let us see how a company tries to achieve, how a company tries to improve information accuracy in a supply chain and thereby enabling achieve coordination in the supply chain. The second managerial lever, improving information accuracy. Sharing point of sale data. Okay, so the example what I was giving of a Procter & Gamble and Walmart is a good example of sharing point of sale data. Point of sale data is nothing but, okay, in the organized retail chain, okay, the counter where you pay cash and check out with your product, that point is called as point of sale, where the sales actually happens inside the store. Point of sale data means, okay, every time, okay, you go to the organized retail chain and you purchase, and when you go to the sales counter, okay, each of the products that you have purchased are scanned by a handheld scanner, okay, by the customer service executive. And when the products are scanned, the product related data is entered, okay, into the computers of the store. Okay, so this data is stored, okay, company wise, okay, customer wise, okay, time wise, this data can be obtained. So if Walmart is willing to share the point of sale data of Procter & Gamble products, okay, then Procter & Gamble will actually have the real-time information about how much of its products are being sold by the Walmart retail stores. But however, such sharing of data, okay, is difficult in case, okay, where the penetration of organized retail is very poor, like, okay, 6 to 8% in India. Then collaborative forecasting and planning. Collaborative, okay, simple meaning, coming together. Okay, if the, in case of again Walmart and Procter & Gamble, if they come together, Walmart and Procter & Gamble, if they come together and make a forecasting, so remember always aggregate forecasts are always more accurate compared to disaggregate forecasts. And Walmart will have the real-time data on the demand for Procter & Gamble. One more company which does collaborative forecasting and planning is Dell Computers. So Dell Computer shares real-time data about the incoming demand for its personal computers, as well as the inventory levels of all the components of Intel. Okay, so Dell shares data, real-time demand data and inventory data with Intel, so that Intel can use the data in its forecasting. So this is collaborative forecasting done by Intel and Dell. So this collaborative forecasting improves information accuracy. It improves the forecasting accuracy. And single stage control of replenishment. Okay. So if there are multiple points, where orders are received and orders are dispatched, so again, coordination becomes difficult to achieve. Say a very simple example, let us say if there is a hall, and there are multiple entrances to the hall. Let's say there are eight entrances to the hall. It becomes difficult to control the movement of the people, with eight doors. Say, assume the same hall has only one door, It becomes easy to control the inflow and outflow of the people. So same way, if there are multiple points where customer orders or buyer's orders are received and the goods are dispatched, it becomes difficult to achieve coordination. So though it is difficult, but sometimes companies can have single stage control of replenishment. So in case of industrial products, it is possible to the extent. So where from only one point will be there, where all the orders will be placed, and from the same point, all the orders will be, invoices will be prepared and dispatches will be arranged. So this help improve coordination as well as improve information accuracy in the supply chain. Okay. For example, when McDonald's entered in India, when they opened their first store, at that point in time, so McDonald's had a single warehouse for the entire Indian market. So all the orders that were placed has to reach only that one warehouse. It was arranged to dispatch the, prepare the invoice and arranged to dispatch the goods from that single warehouse. So this is what we call it as single stage control of replenishment. As the business grows, as the customer increase and the geographical area covered increases, it may be difficult, but with the existing softwares, it is made easy. Two practices of assigning single point of responsibility when sales occurs through retailers. So this is a case of organized retail chains. When sales occurs through retailers, means like Walmart, for example, is a retailer. Sales happen for most of the FMCG company products through retailers like Walmart. In India, Big Bazaar, More, Reliance Fresh, etc. So when sales occurs through retailers, means when products are sold through retailers, there are two practices of assigning single point responsibility in supply chain. The first one is a continuous replenishment programs. So continuous replenishment programs. And one more, vendor managed inventories. So this is based on who will have the inventory and who will fulfill the customer order. So we learn more about it when we write a CRPF, collaborative planning forecasting, at the end of this chapter. There is a separate part dedicated to this. It is slightly complicated, so just for the time being, you remember there are two points of assigning single responsibility. One is continuous replenishment programs, the other is vendor managed inventory. So we have separate part for the in this chapter for these two with examples. So I will deal with them. I'll explain them at the end of the chapter. But for the time being, you can just remember this. So how a company tries to improve information accuracy in supply chain and thereby achieving coordination in the supply chain. Then the third managerial lever is to improving operational performance. So quickly, I will take you back to the obstacles. So the third obstacle in achieving coordination are operational obstacles. So there is a managerial lever. There is a way to overcome these operational obstacles and help achieve coordination in the supply chain. Okay. So this is the third. So improving operational performance. So this managerial lever or strategy helps a company to overcome the operational obstacles and help improve operational performance in the supply chain. So let us learn more about this. So the first aspect here is reducing the replenishment lead time. I repeat again, the lead time or replenishment lead time is the time taken to fulfill a customer order. Okay. So reducing how the replenishment lead time, okay, by reducing the replenishment lead time, okay, the time taken to fulfill a customer order, by reducing it, what advantages the company can achieve? So one is it reduces uncertainty in demand. The longer the time gap between the order and the delivery, okay, it leads to higher uncertainty in demand. So we have learned about it. Longer the duration, higher will be the uncertainty in demand, because the customer may cancel the purchase, the customer may postpone the purchase, or the customer may switch to a competitor to purchase. Then e-commerce, electronic data interchange, cross docking are useful, okay, in reducing replenishment lead time. Okay, so with the resources that these type of companies have, e-commerce companies online, okay, so where order processing becomes extremely faster and easier to handle. Okay, then electronic data interchange, where the information is exchanged, okay, between the buyer and the seller. Cross docking, okay, cross docking is a concept where, okay, the incoming trucks, okay, the incoming trucks from the sub, okay, manufacturer, let us say in case of an organized retailer, okay, so they will have distribution centers. Like I used to tell you, if you remember, in Rayapur in Dharwad, okay, more has its distribution center. So many trucks from different factories like Nestle, okay, Hindustan Unilever Limited, Coca-Cola, PepsiCo, okay, so like these companies, finished goods arrive in truck at the distribution center, okay, in Rayapur. Okay, but I'm not very sure whether cross-docking is practiced at more distribution center Rayapur, but a Walmart retail chain in US, they practice this concept of cross-docking, which help reduce the replenishment lead time. I'll explain. When the trucks enter the distribution center, when the trucks enter the distribution center of Walmart, okay, the goods are not unloaded. The goods are not unloaded. The goods are not unloaded actually from the truck and stored into the warehouse. In fact, one more truck, okay, which is leaving to deliver goods to Walmart stores in US in a particular area. So that truck comes to closer to the truck which has entered in the distribution center with full load of goods. So the goods are transferred from the one truck to another truck, from the incoming truck to the outgoing truck which is going to Walmart stores for delivery. So the goods are actually not stored in the warehouse. The goods are simply transferred from one truck to another truck, okay, and the another truck which is leaving out of the distribution center carries the goods and, okay, supplies to the Walmart stores. So this way it helps reduce, okay, lead time, because if the goods are unloaded and kept in the warehouse, again it will take several hours or one day to deliver the goods from warehouse to the stores. So this way cross-docking enables a company to reduce the replenishment lead time. And one more, okay, strategy is reducing lot sizes. So reduce fixed costs associated with ordering, okay, and transportation. Okay. So fixed costs are always associated with ordering. So if your order quantity increases, okay, if your order quantity increases, you will avail the discount. Okay. So using milk runs to reduce lot sizes. Okay, but our problem here is lot size. Okay. if the order size is too large, okay, due to various reasons what I have learned in the past, okay, it may be due to the communication distortion, it may be due to the bullwhip effect, okay, it may be due to the quantity discounts, okay, various reasons. So how a company can reduce the lot sizes? So one way is using milk runs to reduce lot sizes. I'll explain the concept of milk run. Okay, so when the buyer orders in smaller sizes, definitely the transportation cost and ordering cost are going to increase. So the company manager also need to consider that the ordering and transportation cost must be lowered. So how using milk run, lot size can be reduced as well as, okay, ordering and transportation cost can be reduced. Okay, so milk run is nothing but the one truck which is leaving to deliver the goods to buyer's location, say for example in terms of retail stores, okay, not only carries the goods for only one store or for only one buyer, it aggregates the goods which can be delivered to the multiple stores in the same area or to the multiple customers in the same area, so which enables to fill the truck totally. So we call it a full truck load. Okay, so when the truck is filled with orders to be supplied to multiple customers in the same area, okay, or the multiple stores in the same area, the truck is full, so fixed cost associated with the transportation per unit will be reduced as well as the ordering costs. Okay, so one truck leaves to a geographical area or a territory and it goes to the first buyer or first store and deliver the goods, a part of the goods. Okay, it moves on to the second store in the same area or to the second buyer, then it delivers the order and moves on to the third store or to the third buyer. So we call it milk runs. Okay, so if we consider the FMCG distribution in India from wholesaler to retailer, okay, exactly the same method is adopted to reduce lot sizes but also to lower the transportation cost per unit. So if you can recall, okay, one sales person goes, okay, on day one and he covers many retail stores in a territory and he takes the orders, okay, and next day Tata is usually leaves the distributor warehouse to supply or to deliver the goods of the retailers. So it goes to the first retail store, it delivers the small order, okay, then it moves on to the second retail store, it delivers the small order, it moves on to the third store and so on. So the entire small truck will be filled, so which help reduce transportation cost as well as it help reduce the lot sizes. So this way, by way of reducing the lot sizes, bullwhip effect can be minimized and it helps improve operational performance and help achieve coordination in the supply chain. So I'll take your questions. Okay, so once I complete these managerial levers, then improving operational performance, okay, continues. Rationing based on the past sales and sharing information to limit gaming. So if you can recall, I'll just slightly take you quickly back to the operational obstacle and where we learned about rationing and shortage gaming. Okay, so if you can recall, this is the operational obstacle and we learned something called as a rationing and shortage gaming. Okay, so how this obstacle can be overcome? Okay, that is what we are going to learn now. Okay, rationing based on past sales and sharing information to limit gaming. Okay, so turn and earn is the name of the strategy used by General Motors and Hewlett Packard, okay, in overcoming the problem of rationing and shortage gaming. So quickly, I would like to remind you what is rationing. So when the demand is high and supply is short, okay, the supplier tends to rationing. Okay, rationing means, okay, he supplies the orders, okay, proportionately. He supplies the orders to the buyers proportionately. So I gave you an example. Say if supplier has 100 units and wholesaler one, okay, distributor one has ordered for 600 units, and retailer wholesaler two has ordered for 400 units. Since the supplier has only 100 units, he will supply the goods in the proportion of the orders received by wholesaler 1 and wholesaler 2. So wholesaler, in the proportion, wholesaler 1 will get 60 units and wholesaler 2 will get 40 units. And learning this, okay, if the wholesaler 2 wants to increase the share of his order, okay, he will place the order for also 600 units next month. Assuming the same 100 units are available with the suppliers. So this time wholesaler 1 will get 50 units as well as wholesaler 2 also gets 50 units. So whereas the actual demand for the okay wholesaler 1 is 400 units, but he has placed the order for 600 units in order to maximize his share in the supply. So how that can be prevented? So instead of rationing based on the orders received, which are usually inflated, the rationing or the supply can be made based on the past sales. Both the wholesalers past sales can be considered. Wholesaler 1, past 12 month sales, or wholesaler 2, past 12 month sales can be considered. You can find out the average, or the last year same month sales of both the wholesalers you can consider. So that way, based on the past sales of wholesaler 1 and wholesaler 2, the company can do the rationing or allocate the supply proportionately. And also, if these wholesalers are willing to share the information with the company, that will throw more light and help improve the transparency in the supply chain and help improve operational performance by way of improving information accuracy. So I will break here for a minute or two before I move on to next managerial level. And if you have any doubts, please ask me. I'm going to unmute you all together. Remember kindly, those who do not have questions, kindly mute your audio immediately within 1 or 2 seconds. I repeat, those who do not have questions, kindly mute your audio immediately within 1 or 2 seconds. Thank you. Any questions from students? Any questions? Archana, any questions from your end? Archana Pallay.
No, sir.
Okay, thank you. Prashant, any questions from your end?
No, sir.
Okay, thank you. So one more last chance, any questions? If any questions are there, please ask it. We'll clarify the doubts and then we'll move on to the remaining part. So it looks like concepts are clear. There are no questions. Then I'll mute you all again. Then continue with the remaining part. Then we'll move on to the next managerial lever, that is designing pricing strategies to stabilize orders. So this will help enable the company to overcome the pricing obstacles, the bullwhip effect created due to the pricing policies of the company. Just a minute. So how the company can overcome the obstacles that are created due to pricing in achieve coordination. So in obstacles, we learned how pricing how pricing policies of a firm can result in bullwhip effect. So encouraging retailers to order in smaller lots and reduce forward buying. So generally the retailers order in larger quantities to avail quantity discounts, if you can recall. So how a company can the company can communicate with the retailers and it can convince the retailers to order in smaller quantities so that the bullwhip effect can be reduced. Okay, company policy may change from lot size based to volume based quantity discounts. Consider total purchases over a specified time period. How Hewlett Packard gives discounts to its dealers is based on, okay, so over a period of 1 year, for example. So whatever is the sales made by the dealer, so Hewlett Packard announces, okay, discounts, okay, based on the total sales made by the dealers during a given period of time, generally 1 year. Okay, so this discourage the retailers from ordering in large quantities to avail quantity discounts, as the incentives will be based on volume. Volume here is, okay, actual sales made by the dealers and not on the order size given by the dealers. Okay, then how a company can stabilize pricing, okay, and help reduce bullwhip effect, eliminate promotions. Okay, totally it is not possible, but yes, there are instances where companies have eliminated promotions. Like Walmart practices a pricing policy called as everyday low pricing. Okay, across the Walmart stores, all the merchandise is sold below MRP 365 days a year. Okay, so this ensures, okay, discounts on every visit to the customers. Okay, and this ensures the stability in the demand. This ensures stability in demand, okay, and help reduce bullwhip effect. Okay, then limit quantity purchased during a promotion. So even if a company has to announce sales promotion offers, okay, so in order to prevent the buyers, okay, intermediaries from buying in excess than the actual demand, but they can limit the quantity purchased. So for each retailer or for each wholesaler, okay, they can set some minimum limit only which will be supplied to the intermediaries. These are policies of the company. Company can always do it. Then type promotion payments to sell through rather than amount purchased. So company can, okay, in case of sales promotion offers announced for intermediaries, we call them trade promotions. Okay, the sales promotion offers given to intermediaries like wholesalers and retailers, such promotion payments can be connected to sell through rather than amount purchased. So generally the sales promotion offer payments, okay, given to the retailers and wholesalers are based on the orders placed. But the same can be changed. Okay, the sales promotion payments related to offer can be based on the sell through. How much actually the retailer has sold during the promotion period, or how much the wholesaler has actually sold during the promotion period, the promotion payments can be made based only on the actual sales made by the retailer or by the wholesaler. So that way also it help discourage the intermediaries to ordering from larger quantities than the actual demand and help reduce the bullwhip effect. Okay, so I'll stop here because this is a very lengthier concept, building strategic partnerships and trust in the supply chain, which I'll deal in next class. So we're left with still 1 minute. So if we have any questions, you can ask. Before that, I would like to inform you that we have received a notice from the college. Okay, so where for PG programs like MBA, we have to give an assignment which should include 30 descriptive questions. Okay, so I repeat, course teacher assessment, one assessment of 20 marks, which should include 30 questions. And supply chain management being a 2-credit course, so I will be giving 15 descriptive questions. Okay, so which will be equivalent to 10 mark each. So out of 15, you have already answered, okay, 2 case studies I have given. So each case study carries 2 questions. So they are also part of the course teacher assessment. So only 11 questions are remaining. So I will send you 11 descriptive questions which you have to answer, and all the questions